who are very much with us right here, experiencing the power of being. And when I say the power of being, it's all about healing self and healing others. Once again, a warm welcome to all of you. I hope you've had your lunch, because the sessions that we're moving on with are truly exciting. And, you know, they will put a new chapter in your life when you start realizing as what is being said and how we can improve ourselves, how we can heal ourselves and others. But before that, I would like to thank all our sponsors. First and foremost, platinum sponsors, Vakrangi Gale India Limited, Indraprastha Gas Limited, IGL, Intas Pharmaceuticals Limited. Gold sponsors, Sham Steel, Sun Pharmaceuticals Industries Limited. And the silver sponsors, Cipla Limited, Lupin Limited, Torrent Pharmaceuticals, and of course, our beloved technical partners, Hums Events. With that being said, I hope all the doctors and healthcare professionals are very much active socially. So all you need to do is just go on your social media and put in hashtag unlocking the power of being. And also follow and tag us, which is MHFI, AIMS, and Mind Specialist, which is an online initiative of the Rahat Charitable Trust. You can follow us on www.mhfindia.org, www.rahat.org, www.mindspecialist.com. With that being said, ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor to invite the next personality who is going to bring us a new outlook, a new way of thinking when it comes to healthy lifestyle for a healthy mind. So without further ado, let me invite none other than Professor Shivarama Varambali, Professor, Department of Psychiatry, and currently the officer in charge of the NIMHANS Integrated Center for Yoga, NIMHANS, Bangalore, India. I would also like to invite a very young and a vibrant doctor, Dr. Jaswant Jangra, Senior Resident Academic, Department of Psychiatry, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. So can we have a round of applause for them? Welcome, gentlemen. Over to you.
So today we are very grateful to have Shivaraman sir here with us. So sir will be talking about healthy lifestyle for a healthy mind. And we are very excited to hear you, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Jaswant. Thank you, Anirudh. I'm very happy to speak to all of you. I understand that this is a very widely attended event, particularly focused on the care of those who care for others, you know, doctors, nurses, and other people. And at NIMHANS, we have been researching for a long time on ways to help healthcare professionals deal with the stress, particularly so in the time of the COVID pandemic. So I thank everybody, the sponsors and the organizers, for inviting me. I'm going to try and share my screen for the next maybe 35 to 40 minutes. I will try and share with you my inputs on how we can protect ourselves and be more resilient. Okay. Yes, I think hopefully everybody can see the slide that I am sharing. Maybe I'll make it. Yeah. Dr. Jaswant, can you see the slide? Okay. So basically, this is a photo of NIMHANS, where I am actually sitting, and this is a photo of our garden. This is the middle of the place where the wards are located, and this is one of the unique things. It is built on the model of the Institute of Psychiatry in Maudsley, where we have a garden in between the wards, so that both patients and doctors can have a nature in the midst. So now, whenever we look at some topic, these are the six friends that we ask the help of. And most of the time, most of the information we need can be given by these six friends of knowledge, as they are called. Now, the first question is, what is a healthy mind? What we have to define before we go further. And I really, even if I look all over the world, I don't think I can do better than this definition given in the very ancient Indian text, the Bhagavad Gita, which says, you know, yogastha kuru karmani sangam tyaktva dhananjaya siddhi asiddhyo samo bhutva samatvam yoga vichyate. If you look very closely at the Nimhans logo, Professor M.V. Govindaswamy, who was the founder of Nimhans in 1954, was a noted Sanskrit scholar, and he has taken this and put it inside the logo of Nimhans, you know, way back in 1954. So here, what is being said is equilibrium is yoga, and the ability to be in equilibrium no matter what is the situation is what is to be aimed for. That is the ultimate aim of, you know, the mental process is what he is saying. Of course, Rudyard Kipling in his famous poem, If, much later of course, made the same point. If you can meet with triumph and disaster and treat both these impostors the same, then he goes on to say that, you know, you are a man, my son. And, you know, so the wisdom is not very different. The way of expressing may be different. But what are the signs? If you look at, this is a response of people when asked, okay, what do you, how do you say somebody mind is healthy? They say, you know, person should be happy, well-being should be good, person should feel satisfied, feeling positive. In the era of COVID, positive has a double meaning. I don't mean COVID positive, but positive in terms of feeling happy, feeling something, thinking of the future. And the last two is the mantra of the new generation, that we should find meaning in our lives and unlock our personal potential. So all this together may fit the term what we call as positive mental health. This is what we need to aim for, not just not being ill. You know, I don't have an illness is not good enough. You have to be positively well. And of course, why is it important? We all know from the, you know, time of Thales, we say that mens sana and corpora sana basically means a healthy body and a healthy mind, both are dependent on each other. You cannot have a healthy mind if the body is not healthy, and similarly, if the mind is not healthy, you cannot have a healthy body. And there is a lot of research which shows, for example, diabetes and depression, cancer and mental health, there is a lot of interaction. And generally speaking, it is how we take things that matters rather than what actually happens to us, has been, you know, said by Epictetus long back. So a sane mind and a sound body are very much interlinked. You can say that they are two sides of the same coin. And like I have said, there are many examples for that in the recent medical literature. Then comes the question, who can achieve it? Many people say children. You know, children are naturally happy unless they are being troubled by somebody. So is it limited only to children? Somehow we unlearn how to be happy after we become adults. You know, we think of so many things which all together make us unhappy. If there is no problem today, we think tomorrow there may be a problem, or we remember yesterday's problem. You know, it's a way, as Kishore Kumar says in Anand, you can bring forward problems from the future and make you unhappy today. Children don't do that, so children are naturally happy. So can only children have it? Some people say, no, no, after retirement, you can be happy. After retirement, you started worrying about your finance, your children, your grandchildren. So there are many ways to be unhappy, but actually there is only one way to be happy. You know, that's what we need to find today. And where should we find it? Is it at home? Some people think home is better. If you have problems at home, maybe office is better. Maybe you are on the stage, you are happy. You are playing cricket or tennis, you are happy. Or none of these places, maybe a bar or a restaurant, you can find happiness. People do all these experiments, but unfortunately, most of them don't end up giving you what you are looking for. So the critical or the most important among all these friends of knowledge is, how do we actually do it? So that is what I'm going to focus on for the rest of my thing. And this is a person I want to introduce to the audience. If many of you have worked in mental health, you will definitely have heard of this person. He is famous for two things. One is this concept of flow in positive psychology, and the second is almost unpronounceable surname. So apparently it is pronounced as Csikszentmihalyi, which is very difficult to pronounce, but the book that he has written is a wonderful book where he describes the flow state, where he says people are actually happy when they are in a state of complete absorption in what they are doing, to the extent of forgetting themselves. nothing else seems to matter. So in the modern terminology, we call this as being in the zone, in the groove, and you know, it's a state of intrinsic motivation. It's a very, very wonderful book if you read it. And this optimal experience, what he talks about, he says, is one of the way which you achieve happiness in your life. And this has two components. You have to have a skill set and you have to have a challenge which is able to handle, you know, the skill set is able to handle. So there has to be a matching. If you are too skilled and the challenge is too easy, you get bored. If the challenge is too difficult, you are not able to do it, you get frustrated and you may leave it. So when there is an even match of these two, you get to this state. And where does it happen? Very interestingly, you would of course think of, when you say in the zone, in the groove, you think, you know, think of a cricketer, tennis, or sports. Yeah, sports is one of the most common. Creative, art, singing, you know, many other creative pursuits. But surprisingly, the third most common place where it was found is work. So indeed, work can be a challenge. And if you are good at your work, you can achieve this flow state even in your work. A surgeon doing an operation may achieve this flow state when he is in the OT, you know. And he goes on to say that yoga is one of the oldest and the most systematic way of producing this state. And he says, till now, Western psychology has not been able to come up with any method to match the systematic way in which yoga produces this experience. So this is what yoga, you know, this is in his book written in 1990. And here I was given some, you know, photographs of people who have achieved flow state in their own pursuits. I'm a big fan of Roger Federer and Tendulkar, so I put this photo, and of course the Nightingale of India, Lata Mangeshkar ji. And the fourth person is a person, myself and Dr. Gangadhar are seen meeting the Dalai Lama. This is one person who I have met in my life. I have not met the other three people in this photograph, but I have been able to meet the Dalai Lama, and I can tell you it's a wonderful experience. You know, I spent, me, myself and Professor Gangadhar was the director of NIMHANS till last year. We met him in Bailakuppe, which is a place near Mysore where he comes and stays. And we met him for around 40 minutes. And you actually forget everything else when you meet that person. He's so unaffected, happy, even though there are 1,000 problems which he's dealing with. So then you really find that he's a person who has achieved that state, what is called as flow. So here there are two terms, you know, for example, we say pleasure. I get pleasure from something. It's just an, I eat a good meal. You know, all of you had hopefully had your lunch, and you get pleasure when you eat a good meal. But that is just a satisfaction of a physiological need. What is enjoyment? Enjoyment is when you use your skill. Suppose you cook a meal for your family and they eat that meal and they feel happy. That is enjoyment. That is not just a physiological need, it is something further. And pleasure, of course, leads to contentment, but enjoyment actually leads to change and growth. You become a better person, you become a better cook, better musician. So that is what everybody aspires for. And how, when we come to this, how to do it, I cannot again do better than this. Again, from the Bhagavad Gita, a different chapter. It says, yuktahara viharasya yukta chestasya karmasu yukta svapnava bhodasya yogo bhavati dukkaha. A person who is moderate in all the things, eating, exercise, sleep, if he follows the yoga system, he can mitigate all the material problems of himself, you know, by following the yogic path. So this is the best way to describe moderation in everything is the need of the hour. And these are a few people I have put on some examples here of people who have successfully trained themselves. Now, having talent is one thing, but honing that talent to be able to achieve what you really want to do and in a manner that does not end up hurting other people is a very difficult thing to do. You know, I have given the examples here. For example, Rahul Dravid is an example of a nice guy who finished first. The book title reads actually. It's generally accepted that nice guys do not finish first, but he's an example. Abdul Kalam ji was an example. A man dedicated to teaching, became the president, but passed away while he was actually doing what he wanted to, that was teaching. He was speaking to some students and he passed away. And of course, the person on the left is the famous B.K.S. Iyengar ji, who took yoga to the world, who passed away recently at the age of 93, 94, was doing yoga and teaching yoga till the age of nearly 90. So these are people who have, as you know, Iyengar ji was a very sick child. He had asthma, he had a lot of physical problems, and he took up yoga as a way of improving his own health and went on to become the greatest yoga gurus the world has seen. So these are people who have trained themselves. And luckily for all of us, both the body and the brain are very excellent trainers. You train them properly, they will listen to you and they will, you know, follow your instructions to the T. Now you come, how do we train the brain? Earlier when we were MBBS student, we were taught that the brain is a fairly static organ. You know, you damage a part of your brain, nothing much can be done, the brain does not regenerate. For example, the skin, you cut your skin, yeah, we know that in a few days the skin will, new skin will come. But does that happen in the brain? Not really. But then now we know that actually the brain is a very plastic organ, if not in structure, in function. In fact, that is one of the major differences between, say, for example, a brain and a computer. A computer, some part is burnt. You just have to replace the part. You have no option. The brain, you can't replace that part, but the brain is able to allocate that work to some other area in a course of time. That's how people with stroke, people with other, you know, brain damage recover. Otherwise, nobody would ever recover from a stroke, isn't it? So how does this happen? The brain is able to recognize that this is a problem and shift it, maybe not completely, but majorly to a different part of the brain. And now we are understanding the brain not in terms of areas, but in terms of circuits. So there are interconnected circuits which do a particular job. And how much training these circuits receive, they do their job that much better. For example, the circuits that handle reflex functions are very, very deeply primed. So that once you learn, you will never forget. Say, for example, you drive driving a two-wheeler. Once you learn in your life, 10 years later, you're simply given a bicycle, you can ride it. How is that? That is because the area involved is very extensive and very well trained. Whereas remembering the name of 20 people you met yesterday, it's very difficult. You need to rehearse. You need to train your brain. So the circuits are important, and we understand the brain in terms of circuits. So in a circuit, one part is damaged, the circuit can realign itself, which is not possible only if everything was done in terms of area. So this is a very important thing to understand of the brain. And Donald Hebb is one of the famous people in neuropsychology. He is in fact the pioneer of what is called neuropsychology now. And this is called Hebb's law, that neurons that fire together, wire together. And neurons that are out of sync lose their link. So this is what he is saying here basically. If you repeatedly do something, the circuit becomes more and more active and you become good at it. Fortunately and unfortunately. Fortunately, because the things we really need to do well, a surgeon needs to operate, he trains himself to do it repeatedly. Whereas, what about moods? You repeatedly make a circuit which makes you sad. You are very good at being sad. You know, on the other hand, you train your circuit which makes you happy, you are very good at being happy. So this applies to most things in our life, not only skills. And this is really the basis of our ability to rewire our own brains. As you know, practice makes perfect. And for example, in pilots, they follow something called as a 10,000 hour rule, which means that if a person has done something for 10,000 hours, he is considered to be a master and he can probably land a plane while half asleep or even with his eyes closed, because he has done it for so many times. So the best pilots are considered to be pilots who have this much amount of experience. And as I told you before, there are two kinds of basic memory that we have. The implicit memory refers to things which are very vital to life, walking, cycling, swimming. This you don't need to practice so much. Whereas the explicit memory refers to things that we want to remember. We have to train it quite a lot. So mood is like that. But if you train it for 20 years to be sad, it's very difficult to undo that. So we have to start looking at what is it that we want our brains to be. We want it to be trained to be happy or trained to be sad. You have to make that decision. And Daniel Kahneman, the winner of Nobel Prize in Economics, has spoken of two systems in the human response, that is system one and system two. System one is the sort of emergency fight flight response, which all of us have for emergencies, but unfortunately we tend to use it for non-emergencies also. Suppose somebody calls me a name, my immediate response is to shout or hit. This is system one. Whereas if you use logic and say, okay, what will I get by bad-mouthing this person? Would the things get any better? Maybe you'll think, okay, it's not worth fighting with this person. That is system two. Unfortunately, most of us use system one most of the time and system two only when it comes to our work. Why not when it comes to our emotion, our everyday conversation? We don't usually use. So that's what he says. You have to learn to use system two. Take a break. Think about things that you want to do, unless you know you are avoiding a motorist on the street. Yes, of course, you need to use system one, but not for everything else. This is a very interesting concept to think. There is what we talk of neurogenesis. Most of us know that by 6 or 7 years of age, most of the neurons in the brain are already there. And actually, by the age of 30, we actually start losing neurons. We will never gain them back. But can new neurons be formed even in adults? Yes. Although not in all areas of the brain, particularly in an area called as the hippocampus, which is the, you know, I don't know whether you can see the blue area in the screen, in the scan here, but the hippocampus is very critical for memory. And people who have dementia, for example, you can see the atrophy in the hippocampus. How do we promote this neurogenesis? There are many ways to do it. Yoga is one of them. When I say yoga, I always include meditation. There is nothing called yoga without meditation. Mindless yoga is not yoga. So it has to be mindful, meditative is yoga, and yoga without meditation would be like physics without mathematics. It cannot exist. Intermittent fasting and exercise regimen have also been recently shown to improve neurogenesis, and in fact is the secret to living longer without becoming demented. Cutting down your food in a scientific manner is preserving all the nutrients. Cutting out what is not needed is one way. Having novel experiences and learning new skills. Even if you are 60, you want to learn the guitar, please go ahead. You want to learn driving, please go ahead. These are things that stimulate the brain to improve itself. And the last one I have put is something called an involved reading. This is not just reading. You know, for example, when you read Harry Potter, or sometimes you read some of the epics, you forget yourself. That is what I call an involved reading. And this has been shown to stimulate new neuron development. So one of the things in elderly people is to keep doing something which stimulates you. Maybe Sudoku, maybe learn novels. You have to get involved into it and forget yourself. What is yoga? I mean, there are so many definitions, and the modern yoga can mean anything. You know, if there is apparently something called doga, which is doing yoga with your dog, you know, so it has been trivialized to a great extent recently. But the real meaning of yoga, if you look back into the text, nothing about the body at all. All yoga talks about is in the mind. For example, if you look at the oldest definition from Yoga Vasishta, which says, Manah Prasamanopaya iti yoga. Yoga is a skillful trick to calm down your mind. Gita, I already shown you, Samatvam Yoga Uchyate, maintaining equilibrium is yoga. And Patanjali, considered as the father of yoga, says yoga chitta vritti nirodaha. It is the taming or the control of the oscillations of the mind is yoga. So all these people, if you read the Patanjali Yoga Sutra, it's quite amazing. It has around 196 two-line aphorisms, although the explanation can go to 1,000 pages. There is not a single asana described in it. All it talks about is how yoga can help you control your mind, and the body being fit is just a byproduct of the whole process. And of course, yoga is one of the darshanas or the six disciplines of ancient Indian philosophy. And Patanjali, as I said, is considered as the pioneer of yoga. It's not that he invented yoga. He put or codified yoga into an understandable form and made it into a scientific treatise rather than something very esoteric. And this is what we call as Ashtanga Yoga. It is what described by Patanjali. And in the modern world, most people think it refers only to those two highlighted ones, asana and pranayama. The rest of it, most people don't give attention. But Patanjali says this is a process where you have to do all these things together. Yama and niyamas are basically rules for how to live, what to do, what not to do in your life, like the Ten Commandments, something like the Ten Commandments. Actually, they are ten. Pratyahara is the bridge between what is called as Bahiranga Yoga, which is the external yoga. Yama, niyama, asana, pranayama are the external yoga. Pratyahara is basically withdrawal from the senses, is the bridge between Bahiranga Yoga, and the last three, which are called as the Antaranga Yoga, the internal yoga. Dharana, Dhyana and Samadhi are basically stages in meditative practice. So this is what he describes as Ashtanga Yoga. So it's a gradual process of controlling your behavior first, controlling your body, withdrawing from the senses, and then going into the deeper meditative practices. Even asana, if you take asana, many people say asana is exercise. Indeed, it is not. The idea in yoga is not to exercise. It is to hold the pose. Patanjali's definition of asana is sthiram sukham asana. Ability to hold a pose comfortably and relax within the posture is asana. So if you look at a yoga master doing yoga, you know, it's a very complicated work that posture is doing. That's not yoga. Can he relax in that posture, mindful of the breath? That is yoga. So as you can see, some of the physiological effects of yoga and asana and exercise are actually different, right? So it is not just an exercise. And this is a slide which I use in almost all my presentations, just to show, you know, how you do something is as important as what you do. As you may be aware, the person on the top here is P.K. Iyengar ji, and the person in the below, I don't really know, but then I would imagine that although the posture looks similar, the effects next day morning are likely to be exactly the opposite, right? So doing something mindfully is the really important part, not just the posture itself. And when you come to what happens when you do yoga, many of us, you know, have experienced flexibility, coordination, improved strength. These are the physical aspects. But the mental aspects, what Patanjali talks about, for that you need to do the yoga mindfully. It's not just cardio. Now, what is the evidence to say that yoga helps the brain? This is a very much quoted study which shows that people who do yoga over long periods of time, actually, their brain atrophies at a lower rate than people who do not practice yoga or meditation. So all of us lose, as I said, lose brain cells as we get older. And it is fairly evident, even if you take a CT scan of a 20-year-old person and a 70-year-old person, even a lay person can see the difference. There is less brain and more air in the scan. So whereas if you do yoga meditation long-term, the rate of atrophy is less. This is what has been shown. We have done a small study in the elderly living in old age homes in Bangalore. where we were able to show that even at ages of 60, 65, 70, after 6 months of yoga, their memory significantly improved, their sleep got better, quality of life improved. And as I will show a little later, there was a small structural change in their brain also. I am going to show that. But how does the yoga do all these things? You know, you learn yoga from a teacher. You imitate the teacher. And this, then you perform with mindfulness, and this activates what we call as mirror neurons in the brain. Imitation, you know. That's the process by which you learn. Hopefully not through YouTube. Learn it from somebody who can teach you depending on what he or she knows about you. And you, this important element of being physically relaxed, synchronizing the breath and focus on the experience rather than something else, thinking about, for example, running in the treadmill while looking at TV. It might help you reduce your weight, but it's not going to have any mental effects. So I'm going to talk about something called as cortical inhibition. This is our ability of the brain to control the impulses in the brain. And now there is something called as a cortical silent period. So this is a measure which can be done very simply without using complicated MRI scanners. And as you can see in this person, this ability to inhibit impulses that we don't want is measured through this cortical silent period. What happened? Okay. So this process is dramatically changed by yoga. So our ability to control our brain impulses, as you can see in a single person here, it almost doubled the ability to stop the impulses which you don't want. Does this happen in patients with depression? Indeed. So you can see in this slide that patients with depression had decreased ability to stop these things they don't want in their brain. And that is the reason possibly they keep ruminating on things which are negative. It's very difficult for them to stop this process. After they did yoga, this ability to inhibit significantly got better. Another simple example about something which all of us have heard in our lives, Om. It's a very simple syllable, but the that component, the vibratory component, has a very strong physiological effect, which we have shown in this paper. What we did is that we asked people to say Om in a particular way, and we took a brain scan while they were doing it. And what we found is that actually it deactivates the part of our brain which controls emotions, particularly the negative emotions, a system called as the limbic system of the brain, which is responsible for this fight flight response. This is a very simple study, but a very profound implication it has is that the simple practice of Om every day can make you much calmer. We have been able to recently replicate this study and show that the effects of a yogic chanting called as Brahmari, which is like the sound of a bee, that also can produce the same effect. In fact, there is a very book, famous book written by the Goldman husband and wife called as the Humming Breath. It's available, I think, on Amazon. People who are interested can read it. It talks about all this phenomena. This is another recent study of elderly women who have been practicing yoga and meditation for a long time. Again, shows that they did not have the atrophy that was expected for their age. This is the study I was talking about, done at IMHANS by my colleagues and myself. And what it shows that after 6 months of yoga, elderly people doing yoga actually had a small increase in the size of their hippocampus. Like I told you, hippocampus is one part of the brain critically involved in memory and having a potential to actually have new neurons in the hippocampus. It's a wonderful study because it means that we need not get worried about our age. Even at that advanced age, it is possible to change your brain. So what we have been doing at IMHANS, we have been looking at, you know, yoga for a long time. Initially, the departments of neurophysiology, clinical psychology. We collaborated with the Art of Living Foundation, Swasa University, which is a deemed university of yoga in Bangalore. Then we had a center from the advanced yoga center from Morarji Desai, National Institute of Yoga, New Delhi. in 2007, and that is when we started giving clinical yoga services to patients suffering from neuropsychiatric disorders. In 2014, the NIMHANS Integrated Center for Yoga, NIMHANS, started its own center. And in 2019, I'm very happy to say that we have now established a department of integrative medicine, which involves Ayurveda, yoga, and modern psychiatry together. So all the doctors work together to help the patients. I'm not going to spend much time on this. This is a little technical, but I want to bring to your attention that the researches done in NIMHANS have shown that yoga can actually help patients with depression, schizophrenia, memory problems in the elderly, alcohol dependence, and many other disorders. Not only we have shown that it helps, we also shown some links to how does it help. For example, in depression, it decreases cortisol, which is a marker of stress. It increases brain-derived neurotrophic factor, which is a marker of neuroplasticity or the ability to change your brain. And similarly, in elderly, like I told you, it actually increases to a small extent brain matter. So these are the ways in which it is working. A lot of research, of course, needs to be done further. And this is a study which is very recent and very much relevant to what we are talking about today, that people working in these healthcare professionals, particularly students, psychiatry, psychology, social work, people who are in NIMHANS. We did a small study. Adil was doing his MPhil in social work in this study. We taught yoga to people, the students who are undergoing stress. And we found that actually there was a significant improvement within 2 weeks in their well-being and cognition, which lasted as long as they were follow-up. And this implication is that, you know, Harvard University, as many of you may know, has introduced a mandatory mind-body medicine 1 week course for all medical postgraduates. So we call it yoga, they call it mind-body medicine. Ultimately, it's the same thing. So it's very interesting to see that the West adapts these things far faster than us. And then, you know, we look at Harvard and we say, oh, of course, we should also be doing this. You know, it's better that we adapt the wisdom of our own traditions before, you know, other people adapt it. But you know, all the world can use it. There's no problem. But this is something that we have been able to show. And very interestingly, if you look at this chart, what is the feedback from these people? The majority of people felt that it improved their mental health, to some extent physical health, and very importantly that yellowish orange, their state of feeling, their emotional expressions every day, it helped a lot. This is within 2 weeks. And imagine, you know, you do it for 10 years, what it can do for you. Of course, there were issues and barriers, you know, time, other things, but this is something that will be published shortly. It's been accepted in the International Journal of Yoga. And I'm coming towards the last part of my presentation. Is it only yoga that can do this? You know, of course not. There are many ways. What some people are, you know, I have called this as circadian lifestyle. There's a lot of work on this now, which we align our, particularly meals and exercise, to the circadian rhythm. You know, this is what our ancestors did. As you know, many people in India do not eat after sunset, because they believe that after sunset, the body's metabolism slows down and you should eat the biggest meal in the afternoon, and evening you should slowly start eating less and less. So that is aligning the circadian. Intermittent fasting, again, taken from the ancient Indian tradition, is now a big fad in the West. And the other things I have already spoken to you about, these are all things which can help you. So if you don't want to do yoga, by all means, do one of these other things and improve your ability to, you know, handle your own brain. Coming to a crisis situation, say COVID-19 we have had. Even here, this is a famous, what is called as a serenity prayer attributed to Reinhold Niebuhr in 1943. You know, in many schools this is taught, but even that has a parallel in Shantideva of Nalanda University. Back in the, he says, if there is a remedy when trouble strikes, why should you be dejected? And if there is no remedy, what is the point of being sad about it? You know, so this is The modern version is the serenity prayer. And so this is what we need to remember, except that we cannot control everything in and around us. Focus on what we can do rather than what are the things we cannot do. Make a list or a diary to help you do this on a daily basis. Focus on the short term. Life is so uncertain. So many people we know have passed away because of COVID or other things. So while you are here, you should try to do whatever you can. And remember, most things pass away. Good things, bad things, all pass away. And this is something that will help us to retain the state what the Bhagavad Gita called as samatvam. So to conclude my presentation, I would put one or two slides just to remind you what I have spoken about. So positive mental health or a healthy mind is a matter of strengthening and training what brain networks we want. You have to train them. Luckily for us, the brain is an excellent training. Neuroplasticity, which is the ability to rewire or repair our brains, is possible in all of us, no matter what our condition, how old we are. And enjoyment and flow experiences lead us to growth and change. To do all this, yoga is one of the most systematic methods. And many other things like intermittent fasting, having novel experiences, developing new skills, involved reading, or other ways. So challenge yourself. Enjoy that experience of being challenged, trying to do the best you can, and focus on yourself and what you can control rather than running a race that the world asks you to run, comparing yourself with other people. All of us are running different races in our lives. So it's not that all of us have to be on the same racetrack. So for example, we have, during the COVID crisis, for almost 1.5 years, we have been running this free yoga session for the public. A tele online session, and there are almost now 500 or 600 people who have attended it. Around 50 people continue to attend every day. This is something on a small way that we have, anybody can join it. It's there on the NIMHANS website as well as the website of the NIMHANS Integrated Center for Yoga, which is nimhansyoga.in. So people are free to join. I would like, of course, acknowledge all our collaborators, the NIMHANS team, Professor Gangadhar, who was my mentor, the director of NIMHANS, and the person who sort of pioneered this whole thing at NIMHANS. And thank you very much. I hope it has been useful for all of you. And I think I will stop sharing here. I have put my email here if somebody wants to write to me. I hand it back to Dr. Jaswant.
This was a really, really very wonderful presentation. And thank you so much, sir, for such an enlightening presentation. In a wonderful way, you presented all the aspects of yoga and healthy lifestyle, the neurobiological, the spiritual one, clinical research related, all the aspects you presented in such a simple way that I think most of us, we got our concepts cleared. Like, there were many doubts since many months and years that we had in our mind. And we are very, very enlightened to hear you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, there are some questions which our audience, they have asked. So I would like to read those questions.
Sure.
One of our audience asked that, sir, we have world yoga competitions all across the globe. The West has been very enthusiastic in learning and healing through yoga. So what can be done to increase the participation in our nation, India?
Yeah, this is a good question. Like I said, I don't entirely agree with this concept of a competition of yoga. Now, what do you mean by a competition? So, can I be flexible as Iyengar or my yoga teacher? That is the unfortunate thing. Although the West has, like I said, taken it on in a big way, unfortunately, they have taken it on as a different kind of cardio or a different kind of exercise, as if it is just a bodily function. It is not really. You know, as I showed, yoga is all about the mind. And I think we need to send out the message that yoga is not something that only super fit models can do. You know, Shilpa Shetty's yoga, she's good at yoga, but is that what you want from yoga? So when a person looks at yoga, we have to look at what is it that we want from yoga. Okay, you want a flat stomach, by all means, you know, do fast Surya Namaskar, you do cardio, you do whatever you want. But if you really want mental effects, you have to do yoga the traditional way, which is putting the mind first. So if you cannot bend 90 degrees, absolutely no problem. Don't push your body beyond the pain limit. In fact, listening to your body is one of the most important aspects in yoga. If your body is saying this is painful, that means that you are exceeding the limit. So please don't run a race or do a competition. The only person you are competing with in yoga is yourself. Can I be better today than what I was yesterday? Yes, please do that. Can I do this asana or pranayama better than what I was doing 2 weeks back? Yes, please do it. Can I do it as good as Shilpa Shetty? No. That's not the way you look at yoga. So I think you should reimagine this term of competition into competing with yourself. And improve every day. Yes, that is indeed a very good competition. Not in comparison with other people. And as to the second part, how to improve the yoga following in India. I think the current government has done a lot of work in that area. But most importantly for children. See, like I said, children do not learn from being told. They learn by seeing. So if you tell the child, hey, you do yoga, the child is not really going to do yoga. If they see the mother and the father doing a meditation or a yoga or exercise or whatever for that matter, over the time they will follow. So we all learn by imitation. So that is, I think, the way. So the people who want to talk about yoga should be doing it and showing it to the public. Only then it will.
Yeah, thank you, sir. This definitely clears the cloud over the mind that the people that need to take initiative from the, mainly the adults, they need to take initiative from themselves. They need to put an example to the younger generation, and definitely the younger generation will follow them.
Yeah, because see what has happened is that because of all these competitions and all this thing, the impression has been given to a lot of people that yoga is a very difficult thing to do. You know, you do Ustrasana or you go upside down. That's not really necessary to obtain the mental benefits from yoga. All you need to do is maybe some basic pranayama and some meditative practice 15 minutes a day. You know, that's not very difficult. And what has happened is in their quest to show yoga as a very wonderful thing, people have gone overboard and made it look extremely difficult as though it's some Olympic sport. That's not the way that yoga should be perceived.
Exactly, sir. Also, sir, like one question from my side that nowadays the people, they would ask, they come to the OPD. Once we advise them to do meditation or yoga, then the next question, the obvious question is that, sir, what kind of yoga we should follow? There are a lot of kind of yoga, CDs, YouTube lessons, online lessons, or different ways of yoga are there in the surrounding. So which one we should follow? That is their question, sir. So kindly guide us.
This is a very important question, because if the doctor says do yoga and the doctor does not know what yoga to be doing, that's perfectly okay. But at least you should know who is the person who can guide this patient what to do. For example, now in the context of mental health, a person with psychosis, schizophrenia, meditation may not be a good thing. Now, there is research to show that actually meditation can actually worsen people's psychosis, simply because both meditation and psychosis are you know, things where dopamine is increased. So what kind of yoga a person with psychosis should do? We actually have done quite a bit of research on this. And if people are interested, there is a very simple book that we have published. I don't know whether people can see here. I don't know whether this virtual background will allow me to show it. Let me try and change it. Okay. Now I think people can see. So this is a book which we have published. It's available on Amazon. This is for mental health professionals. It shows basically that the science and art of yoga, mental and neurological healthcare, it's called. And this basically has listed the what yoga can be taught for what kind of condition. But the second thing, in context of your question, I would really suggest that people should really learn yoga from a teacher. I know a lot of YouTube and things are there, but that YouTube person may not have made that yoga for you. You have a cardiac problem, you have a low back problem, you might have a knee problem, you might have a depression, and that yoga which is on YouTube, you know, may not be the best for you. So please learn yoga from a person who is authorized to teach it. You know, it's just like, you know, I know all the medications are available in the pharma shop, but we don't go to the pharma shop, we go to the doctor. That is because the doctor knows what medication is good for you. Just like that, I think people should learn it from a teacher, simply because there are indications and contraindications for most of the yoga practices. When should you do yoga? You need an empty stomach for some time. You know, when you should not do yoga, or if you're pregnant, what you should not do. There are all list of these kind of things. So it's very important that, yes, like you said, the doctor should be able to answer, but the patient should ask, okay, sir, is there something that I should not do? For example, in neurosurgery, people who have low back problems, they should usually not bend forward. Right? So the yogasanas which involve bending forward, part of the Surya Namaskar, may not be good for them. It might worsen their problem. So these are very important things. And therefore, I think, it, like integrative medicine here, over the time, I think all medical institutions will have integrative medicine units where yoga person will be there who would look at the diagnosis, look at the person's condition and suggest the appropriate yoga practices. I know in the private sector already Vedanta and many other places have this kind of a setup. We are trying to push this in the government institutions in India. Hopefully it will happen.
Sir, another participant, they have asked a question that, sir, to train the brain, as you mentioned, would affirmations constantly applied can help in a quicker transformation? And do you have any personal affirmation that you can share with us?
Well, affirmations can help people who otherwise are very distracted or not able to, you know, focus on the present moment. But the simplest thing I would say is what I spoke about some time back. In what way can I be better today than I was yesterday? Can I be less angry today? Can I be less sad today? Can I be more happy today? Can I love myself and other people a little more today? It's the question that you need to ask. And if you can do even 1% a day, 100 days, it will be 100%. You know? So I don't think you necessarily need an affirmation saying, I'm a good person, I'm a good person. Yeah, for some people it does help. But it's a very dumbed down way of doing things. Our brain is much more intelligent. We can do better things, you know, focus on, okay, I'm going to focus on the next 1 week. Okay, I will not have an argument at work. Okay, I will try to resolve things without an argument. That works wonders actually, especially in families, even the COVID and all the stress around, you know, everybody is upset. You know, you put yourself in the other person's shoes. Why is this person angry? Maybe they have their own problems. So can I be less upset with that, that this person is angry with me? Would be a wonderful way of looking at things. If affirmation helps you, I don't have any objection, but It's not a necessary requirement for growth.
Yeah, very nicely explained, sir. Thank you, sir. Another medical student, MBBS student, he asked a question that, do you think that some time has come to make yoga mandatory for the medical students in UG?
Yeah, like I was talking about Harvard. But somehow, whenever you make something mandatory, the reception is not very good. You know, you say, you know, don't drink. People drink methyl alcohol and lose their eyes. So I don't think that approach will work. But should it be available in all schools? Yes, of course. Unfortunately, again, the issue here is that if you look at any good private school in India today, a yoga instructor will be available. It's not the same in government schools. And this is where the majority of our rural children go. And in fact, if you look at yoga and Ayurveda today, the tragedy is that it is much more in demand in the urban educated classes than the village classes. You know, and it's not that there are no teachers of yoga in the rural. They look at, you know, US and they look at something else and they think eating a pizza is the ultimate thing in life, you know. Unfortunately, we have forgotten our own things. Whereas in the urban cities, in Bangalore, for example, there is a lot of demand for Ayurveda, a lot of demand for yoga. People are willing to, you know, go any distance to find. In the village, the yoga instructor, nobody cares for him, you know. So making it mandatory, I don't think will really work. Making it available and the adults doing it. Say, for example, the teachers of the school do some meditative practices every day. Just that is enough to motivate the children to do it. You don't have to make the children do it by saying, if you don't do it, I will whack you. It doesn't work. You know, children don't learn by that. Children learn by looking at what the teachers do. If the teacher is doing and saying, look, I did yoga today, I feel much better. Somewhere down the line, the child will do it. So I don't think going mandatory will work in a democratic or a free country. Maybe in North Korea it might work, but not here.
Yes, sir. Definitely, as you told that integrative, the Department of Integrative Medicine, this is going to be like this role model of NIMHANS. This is going to be replicated throughout the India. And this is very nice initiative, very nice initiative for the well-being of our healthcare professionals and our citizens, definitely.
I think in AIMS also some similar center is there, and in PGI Chandigarh also a center is coming up. Dr. Akshay Anand is actually starting up a center there. So I hope this will go across the entire country.
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir. Sir, another person, they asked that how can a person with some kind of disability practice yoga? So you mentioned about them, about that to some extent, but please just.
Like I said, there are very different versions of yoga. For example, Iyengar yoga uses props. Suppose somebody cannot sleep, they will use a bench, they will use a chair. And many of the yoga practices can be simply done sitting on a chair. Absolutely no need for a yoga mat or any equipment or any complex yogasanas. Absolutely not. That is what I said. Yoga is individual to each person. The way I do yoga may be a little different from the way another person does it, but the benefits do not depend on the complexity of the practice. The benefits depend on how comfortably you are able to do it, how much you do it for, and how much practice you do. So it's definitely for disabled people, yoga is definitely very good. In fact, we teach yoga to patients with stroke in NIMHANS, in people with Parkinson's disease, people with Wilson's disease, and many of these people with Parkinson's have shown a very good response to yoga. Even Tai Chi for that matter. Tai Chi is a very, so some kind of a slow motion version of yoga. It's a Chinese thing. Actually, there is quite a bit of evidence that both yoga and Tai Chi can help Parkinson's patients who cannot, you know, walk well and all those things. So yes, it is definitely possible, but that is where I said yoga instructor is critical. What the person should do, what he should not do, should come from the instructor and not from YouTube.
Sir, thank you so much, sir. you cleared almost all the doubts. We still do have some doubts, but most of these have been addressed in the discussion part. So we have reached our time limit, but sir, that was like this 1 hour was very fruitful to all of us, and all the participants, they are like praising this session. We have a lot of messages for the praises. So sir, thank you so much for the wonderful session.
Thank you, Dr. Jaswant. I'm happy to share this with you and with all the people who are watching. And thank all the organizers again. Namaste.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.